Thank you to all of you for attending and to our generous moderators and our panelists. Actually, Dr. Shanawani is going to give closing remarks. And before he does, I want to mention two things that might be of relevance before people disperse. The first being that tomorrow, the conference is not here. Please do not come here. This building will be occupied by some other people. But rather, it's in Palmer Commons, which is next door. And so if you just leave the exit here and make a right and go up that walking ramp, you will enter Palmer Commons. The conference is on that area. There will be some volunteers at the door to guide you should you come late and not be able to find your place. But just remember that. The second thing is some people I know are leaving today and they would like their CME certificates. We have them outside. You will need to give us that evaluation form in order to get that CME certificate. So please do so. And the third thing is that we have a reception for all of you to mingle after this talk. I'm going to turn now over to Dr. Shanawani to give some closing remarks.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلوات الله والسلام على رسول الله. I first by invoking the name of God and asking for his, thanking him and praising him and asking him to bless us all coming today. And I send, ask for his praise on our prophet, on his name be peace. Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you all. Welcome, greetings, what a day. It's been a long one, I'm pretty beat. I think you guys are all too. We're gonna go for round two tomorrow. This has been the culmination of 2 years of work between me and the good Dr. Padella. And this is sort of a defining moment for the two of us after, I think, a 10-year journey for the two of us coming from different ends. Asim from a traditional upbringing of Islamic studies and me coming in as a physician with an interest of ethics and policy. And both of us realizing that the relationship between medicine, ethics, and our particular religion in this country has been at best tenuous and needs cultivation, nurturing, and growth. And although there have been some wonderful individuals, and Asim gave a wonderful introduction on this, I think there's a ton of work to be done, and I hope today you've seen about the oceans of knowledge and things that could be done. I think, you know, as ethics, you know, has this relationship between advocacy and policy and religion and biology and clinical medicine and the social sciences, I think there's so much that I know I don't know. And I hope that we can all come together with a shared sense of humility and learn and the opportunity to learn from one another. Dr. Brody at the beginning spoke about the evolution of ethics and talked about ethics as a living, breathing culture that is here within our society and grows from and informs our society and how we can inform it as part of a pluralistic society that we're blessed to live in. Dr. DeVries talked about how ethics can flow from country to country, from nation to nation, from society to society, in ways that are planned and unplanned, and in ways that are both positive and negative. And I think Dr. Vischer talked to us about how the dialogue between the religious community and secular communities that exist out there is not limited to the Muslims, it's not limited to Islam, and that there is a wonderful, robust dialogue that occurs between Christians in the greater society, and Jews in the greater society, and I would suspect Hindus in the greater society, and Buddhists and Sikhs and every other faith tradition that exists here and around the world. Professors Jackson, Sheikh Musa, and Imam Hassan talked about some of the diversity, the controversies, and again, just sort of the fact that Islamic law is this living, breathing, evolving culture and growing in a way. And that there, as I've mentioned before, just oceans of knowledge. And I think today in the 8 hours that we've been together, I think we've given you a taste of maybe a thimbleful's worth of that. And I hope that you guys see that with us today. And Dr. Hamdi, Professor Hamdi, who's with us, showed us the value of looking at the beach, I think. And when you look at it up close, you see that it's not one uniform piece of land, but there's granularity and diversity in the grains of sand. And likewise, a community of 1.2 billion people is not a monolithic entity. And I think there is value in the social sciences, sociology, anthropology, and methodologies and science that they bring that can really inform us as ethicists and physicians and policymakers, especially when we try to fit these one-size-fits-all policies over people that we find out don't really fit so well over people. And Dr. Arizallah is here. He showed us that I think there's an awareness that doctors, we especially as Muslim physicians, that we really need of Islamic knowledge, and showed us
how we can take this knowledge of Islam and what our religion expects of us and try to bring our knowledge of those facts up to speed with our doctoral and postgraduate training in medicine. I sometimes feel personally that I have this doctoral advanced training in pulmonary and critical care medicine, and I have a kindergarten level understanding of Islam, and the institute that has been supporting us, Dar al-Qasim, is an opportunity for us, for example, to go and learn those things in almost a postgraduate fashion, and we're trying to build these opportunities, and there's other ones. And Drs. Barnowski and Imam Jones and Brother Alawan showed us just sort of only a brief seconds glimpse into the massive world that is the hospital-based care. I mean, the Henry Ford Health Center that I used to work for had over 800 physicians on its staff and 16,000 people on its full-time staff in the medical center. And so there's this whole world with its own culture that we as Muslims know very little about and don't interact with, except as Imam Jones said, only when there are these crisis moments that we really don't have a chance to sort of sit down and calmly learn from one another. And tomorrow, I hope you guys can join us as we really sort of get, you know, roll up our sleeves and begin to look at cases. Sister Najah, the previous moderator, myself, and Imam Ali will be talking about cases that we've experienced here in Michigan that I think will be really informative to all of us that'll be here. Before you, I wanted to really acknowledge, like I said, this has been 2 years. I can't imagine, I can't tell you how much money and hours and hours and hours of work making this possible. This came under the guidance of Dr. Arizullah, Dr. DeVries, Joel Howell, who could not be with us today, Professor Jackson, whom you know spoke, Saeed Khan, who apologizes and could not join us today, Scott Kim, who is the director of the Ethics Center here, and Shireen Zaman, the executive director of the Institute for Social Policy and Understanding, which is one of our supporting organizations. There are a number of organizations that provided us time, financial support. We want to be really very thankful to the University of Michigan that provided us this outstanding facility, the Center for Ethics and Public Life, the Middle Eastern and North African Studies Center, the Michigan's International Institute, the Islamic Studies Program, the Office of the Vice President for Research, Michigan's Program in Society in Michigan, the Greenwald Foundation, which is a national bioethics foundation that saw the value in this work and has been and was very generous in their financial support, the Dar al-Qasim Institute, who brought us Dr. Arizullah and Dr. Amin and Sheikh Amin, who will be speaking tomorrow. Again, I mentioned ISPU, the Institute for Social Policy and Understanding, which really has been very interested in this work and some of the policy implications. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Clinical Scholars Program, which gave me Dr. Padella for the 3 years that he's been with us on the faculty here at the University of Michigan. Regrettably, he's our erstwhile faculty. He's taken a position at another outstanding institution, the University of Chicago. But for the last 3 years, they've supported him and they've supported us in our efforts providing us office space and a variety of things. The Muslim Students Association and the Graduate Muslim Students Association, which have provided us all of the volunteer staff that made this smooth and get our slides up and everything like that. We had also particular support from Dr. Rod Hayward, the former director of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, Michelle Heisler, who is Dr. Padella's advisor for the last 3 years, Angie Sullivan, one of the staff of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, Anka Sharma and Katie Gunter, who are some of the staff that have been helping with us. There are so many people that have made this possible. Again, this is really just the beginning. We hope to see all of you again very soon. Well, we hope to see you all here tomorrow and at the reception. But we really hope and pray that, God willing, this is not the last time that we do this, that this really starts on a journey. And please, all of you are grounded in a discipline. It may be social sciences or clinical medicine or ethics or what have you. Take your discipline and use it to inform someone of one of these other disciplines and to learn from them. Because if we can start that dialogue and we start this network and we can weave together this fabric, I really think that we have a lot to offer Islam and that Islam has a lot to offer us, the American society, medicine, ethics, and there's just so many rich opportunities. We've only given you just the briefest of glimpses today, and I hope that this is the beginning of a wonderful journey for all of us as we work together with this incredible religion and the wonderful people that practice it every day. Again, thanks so much, and please enjoy us for reception afterwards.